Okay, good morning, everybody. Good morning to you all. Welcome. Welcome to Calvary Chapel this morning. It's great to see each and every one of you, and a big happy Father's Day to all those hardworking daddies here this morning. Hope you have a very special day. But of course, it is good to be together in the presence of the Lord here this morning, and we're looking forward to a wonderful morning of worship and praise and fellowship together. And I want to begin by reading to you Psalm 100 this morning. Psalm 100. Make a joyful shout to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name, for the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting and his truth endures to all generations. Amen. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we're so thankful this morning that we can come together as the people of God, brothers and sisters in Christ, to worship you today in spirit and truth. And Father, we do pray that you would just inhabit our praises this morning, that you would be pleased to be amongst us, that you would lead us and guide us through this service, through the instruction in righteousness as we gather around your word. May Jesus be uplifted. May he be glorified. May he be enthroned in this place this morning. We ask these things in your wonderful and precious name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together. We're going to begin our service with the great hymn, How Great Thou Art. Thank you.
I see the stars. Thank you, Lord. You are the great one that we worship and praise this morning. We'll continue worship now. We're going to sing another wonderful old hymn, Years I Spent in Vanity and Pride at Calvary. There we go.
Years I spent in vanity.
For the Lord. Yeah, let's continue worshiping.
What gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine. All is mine, and no
Thank you for that love, Lord. Amen. Amen. Men, you may be seated. We'll have our scripture reading at this time.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Happy Sunday to you all, and happy Father's Day to all the fathers here. Our scripture is, just a minute, 150. Yeah, that's 150. Praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and the harp. Praise him with the cymbals and dance. Praise him with the stringed instruments and organs. Praise him upon the sound of cymbals. Praise him upon the high sounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Why don't we stand again and sing another song of worship?
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior. Oh,
Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Father, it's so, so good. And it's our joy and our privilege to be able just to sing the glorious songs of redemption this morning, to sing of our salvation, to sing about all that you have done. The wonderful, wonderful work of redemption. You've redeemed us, you've saved us, you've forgiven us, you've given to us a future and a hope, birthed into us eternal life. And this morning, Lord, we are so thankful. We are so grateful, and we just are delighted to be able to gather together as the body of Christ with our brothers and sisters here this morning, together with one heart and with one voice, singing our praises to the Lord of hosts. We thank you and we praise your holy name. Amen. 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 Please do be seated. Do be seated. Such a joy to be together this morning. I'm glad that the heat didn't stop you from singing and praising the Lord today. But I want to begin just with a few thank yous. A few thank yous. I know that most of us enjoyed a wonderful barbecue last Sunday after the church, and Robert and Rosemary are not here today because they have another barbecue that they're organizing for a group in their village, and so our prayers and thoughts are with them today, but it was a great time. I'd like to thank Robert and Rosemary for their hospitality, and indeed for all of you who helped out, and it's always a lot of work. But we had a great time, and we'd like to thank everyone for coming and for all the hard work that you put in. And we are planning a second barbecue early in September, and so watch out for the date of that. Second thank you really is to all those who helped yesterday. We had a very special time yesterday, a great send-off for our sister Jeanette Medley. It was a beautiful service. Sid shared beautifully about his love for Jeanette and his years of marriage with her, and we heard all about Jeanette's life and her years of serving the Lord here. And it was amazing, you know, just how many lives Jeanette and Sid have touched in the short space of time they've been in England. And yesterday was a testament to that. And it was a great blessing, a great send-off, a great time of rejoicing. We were able to look back, give thanks, remember, but also we were able to look forward with hope and with joy, because we have that eternal life that has been given to us in Christ. And we know that one day soon we will be reunited with Jeanette, and it will be a glorious, glorious day. And so thank you to all those who were with us yesterday. Okay, I just want to give you a few notices and then one final announcement. So first of all, coming up, we've got a busy week coming up. Tuesday, Little Lights at 9:30. The Lord has been blessing Little Lights. There's been new mums coming along, and it's been a great, great time. And so pray for Little Lights, Tuesday, 9:30. Coffee morning will be taking place this week, of course, at 10 a.m. here in the church. The Wednesday home group will be taking place on Zoom as normal, and the Thursday groups will be meeting once again here in the church, and it will be a special prayer and preparation evening for Teach the Word. We've got the Teach the Word conference coming up on Saturday. It's a huge undertaking. We've got something like 700 people booked in. And so it's a big deal, and it's a lot of work. Now, I know we have 35 volunteers amongst you who have volunteered to help, and we thank you for that. And so if you can, you don't have to, but if you can come along on Thursday, we'll be organizing things and prepping and praying for the conference on Saturday. It's open to everybody. You're all welcome to come along and join in on Thursday night as we prep and pray for the conference on Saturday. Okay, and that, of course, leads on to the conference on Saturday. Teach the Word, starting at 10 a.m. this coming Saturday morning. I would, a little tip, if you want to park outside the venue, then get there early. Try and get there early, okay? Because the car park does fill up, and then you have to, it's every man for himself after that point. you just have to find. There are places to find, but you've got to go and find them, okay? And so I think we have 70 or 80 car parking spaces, and then it gets full, and so you have to then go and find yourself a space. Or park and ride. Park and ride. Is that right? Park and ride. Or park and ride. I thought it was sign language. Steve was going like this. Yeah, that might be the better option, actually, to park and ride. It's only right down the road, so you know where it is. So do come along. If you haven't booked in, there's still time to book in. We can still fit you in. And so do come along, and we're looking forward to a fantastic day. Please pray for the day as well, if you can. We have a team flying over from California to help us. From my brother-in-law's church, Vision Calvary Chapel. And one member of the team arrived early this week, and she's staying with my mum, and she's over there, Wendy. Let's give her a welcome, shall we? It's great to have you with us, Wendy. Wendy is my sister's best friend. And so it's great to have you with us today, Wendy. Okay, let me see. What else have we got? That's Saturday then. A few things coming up. Ladies' prayer lunch on Friday, the 30th of June, here in the church. All are welcome. Please come along. If you haven't joined yet, do so. They have a great time of fellowship. And then Sunday, the 23rd of July, of course, we're having a baptismal service downstairs. Please give us your name if you'd like to be baptized on the 23rd of July. Now, I mentioned a few weeks ago that there's a new movie coming out about the Calvary Chapel movement. Do you remember that? It's called Jesus Revolution, and it's the story of the beginning of the Calvary Chapel movement. It's in the View Cinema being released. That's the View Cinema near the Kassam Stadium, by the football stadium, the large cinema there. And there are three showings, one this Saturday, when we're all at Teach the Word. So I'm not going to tell you about that one. There's one on Sunday, but there is another showing, which I am going to with my wife, Hannah, and we'd love as many of you to come with us, if you can, at 3:30 p.m., that's in the afternoon, on Tuesday the 27th, so that's a week Tuesday. So if you'd like to come along to the movies with us and watch Jesus Revolution, it's not a comprehensive story of the movement of Calvary Chapel, but it focuses on one particular pastor, Pastor Greg Laurie, who many say today has sort of filled Billy Graham's shoes as he goes and does huge gospel crusades around the US and around the world. And it's his story, but of course the story of Calvary Chapel is all wrapped up in the movie as well. I haven't seen it myself, and so I'm hoping it's good. But please, if you'd like to come along, it's 3:30 p.m. Tuesday the 27th at the View Cinema. Okay, that's all the announcement. The notice is just one final announcement. And many of you will already be aware, but not all of you probably, that Nathan and Becky are going to be moving up north to Oswestry in Shropshire in about 4 or 5 weeks' time. As you know, they've been with us for many, many years, and it's with great sadness that I make this announcement, I have to say. They've been an outstanding couple and family in our church over many, many years, and I was writing down last night all the areas of ministry that they've been serving in. In Little Lights, of course, they pioneered the mums and babies group Little Lights. They've been involved in the worship team, in the creche, and Nathan serves on the leadership, leading home groups and Bible teaching. Nathan runs the men's football team, the AV and the tech, hospitality, involved with the young people, and I'm sure I've missed many other jobs. In fact, when I finished the list, I said to Hannah, we can't let them go. We can't let them go. So I'm going to cancel this announcement right now. We will be saying goodbye to them in about a month's time, and so we'll pray for them on their last Sunday. But Oswestry is sort of the area where Nathan's from. He's got much of his family there, his parents are there, and he's got a lot of roots in that area. And so they're going to be up near Nathan's parents and Nathan's wider family. And so do pray for Nathan and Becky. Do pray for them as they prepare for the move. As you know, moving is always very stressful. It's a lot of work. And so we do pray for them. And I'll have chance before you go, but I deeply, deeply thank them for their years of service and labor in the Lord here amongst us. And of course, our labor in the Lord is never in vain. Never in vain. And I'm sure the Lord will bless them. And I'm sure the Lord has something very special prepared for them. Okay. Do continue to pray for the Baptist Church down below. I will be leading their service this morning. Steve led their service last Sunday, so I will be slipping downstairs shortly. But do keep the Baptist Church in your prayers. They lost a member of their congregation suddenly just this past week also. And so I'll be bringing a word of comfort to them this morning as Steve comes and brings, I hope, a word of comfort to you as well today. And so with that, the children can go and leave us for their teaching. Okay, Steve. Pastor Steve will now come and bring the word. Thank you.
Thank you, Philip. Good morning to you all. Now, next Sunday, we have a special guest speaker all the way from California, Pastor Jack Hibbs, pastor of Calvary Chapel, Chino Hills in Southern California, will be with us next Sunday. He is, of course, joining us for the Teach the Word conference where he'll be speaking on Saturday, and we're looking forward to having him with us here next Sunday morning. Last week in our time together, we concluded 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. And moving into 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, there is a change of emphasis, a change of theme. And before we get to that, and we'll get to that after Teach the Word, there's just something else from chapter 1 that I want to share with you this morning, because you may recall that last week, looking at 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 9 and 10, Paul remarked at how the Thessalonians had turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. Their Christian lives were characterized by serving God. And oftentimes our service of God is seen through our serving of others. Now that was an interesting statement, a statement we all understand. We understand that as Christians we are called to serve the Lord, and indeed we are called to serve others. But a few weeks before, we were in verse 6 of chapter 1. In which Paul told us that the Thessalonians were also imitators of Christ. They were servants of God and of others, but they were also imitators of Christ. That is to say, they patterned their life after Jesus. And indeed, we are called to do the same, aren't we? We are disciples. We are followers of Jesus. Jesus is our example. It is God's will and purpose for us to be like Jesus. But when we put those two things together, serving God and serving others, along with following the example of Jesus, we need to make an important connection. Because it's one thing on the one hand to think, yes, I understand that I am to serve the Lord. But If I am following Jesus' example in serving the Lord, then that implies that Jesus himself also came to serve. Serve his Heavenly Father and to serve others. And that is something that is foundationally important for us to understand. That before we ever serve the Lord, we need to become recipients of the Lord serving us. Now, to some of you, that might sound a bit strange. To some of you, that might even sound completely wrong. But that's what Jesus said. And I want to share with you this morning from Mark's Gospel, chapter 10, verse 45 in particular, which brings this all together in a wonderful and quite remarkable statement of our Lord, in which he said, "For even the Son of Man," speaking of himself, "did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many." Father, we thank you for your word this morning. I pray that you would open your word to our hearts. By your Spirit, you would teach us, you would encourage us, you would help us to grow in our knowledge of you, and indeed help us grow in our understanding of what it means to serve you and to serve others, having been served by the Lord Jesus Christ himself. And Father, we commit our time to you this morning. We ask that you would bless your word to our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, before we look at verse 45, we just need to set the context in which Jesus made this remarkable statement. Because Jesus spoke these words at the conclusion of a discussion that he had with his disciples. And that discussion was about greatness in the kingdom of God. Now, if you go back to verse 35 of Mark chapter 10, we see that James and John, two of the disciples, two brothers, the sons of Zebedee, they came to Jesus with a request. Take a look at verse 35. It says, "James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to Jesus saying, 'Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask.'" Now, there's a good question, isn't it? How many times have we made that request of God? We pray, "Lord, we want you to do whatever we want you to do." And just based on that question alone, we get an idea about where this conversation is going to go. Because we see right from the get-go, the motivation of the disciples here is off. They're concerned about getting what they want, as opposed to asking Jesus what he wants. But notice how gracious Jesus is to them. Verse 36, Jesus said to them, "What do you want me to do for you?" And so, verse 37, they said to him, "Grant us that we may sit one on your right hand and the other on your left in your glory." In other words, they said, "Jesus, we want you to give us the highest place of prominence in your kingdom. We want to be at the top. We want to be the most prominent in your kingdom." So what did Jesus say? Verse 38. Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you ask." You know, and oftentimes if I could hear Jesus audibly responding to some of my prayers, I suspect that many of my prayers would be met with those words. "Steve, you don't know what you're talking about." We have our ways and the Lord has his ways. And my way and God's way are often two very different ways. And so Jesus says to the disciples, you don't know what you're asked. You don't know what you ask. You don't understand. And then he goes on to explain. He says, are you able to drink the cup that I drink and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? And so they said to him, verse 39, we are able. So Jesus said to them, you will indeed drink the cup that I drink, and with the baptism I am baptized with, you will be baptized. But to sit on my right hand and on my left is not mine to give, but it is for those for whom it is prepared. Now, there's just a couple of things to note about this very interesting exchange between Jesus and these two disciples. I think the first thing to point out is that James and John weren't entirely wrong in everything they were saying here. Oftentimes, we point out where they were wrong, but I think to give them some credit, there are a couple of things here in which they were right. Because firstly, they clearly believed that one day Jesus would indeed rule in glory. Otherwise, they wouldn't have asked the question. And that's a good thing. That's true. They acknowledged the lordship of Jesus. It was an expression of faith in Christ and in who he was. And that was good and that was right. A second thing which we can commend them for is that implied in their question was the reality that they wanted to be in the kingdom with Jesus. They wanted to be part of his future kingdom, and that was a good thing. And that was the right desire. And so there were some things that were good that we can pull out of their response. But while they got those things right, they also got some pretty significant things wrong in this exchange. Because while they understood who Jesus was and that one day he would indeed rule and reign forever, they did not understand the principles of the kingdom of God. They did not understand the principles upon which honor would be bestowed in the kingdom. And this is what Jesus said to them in verse 38 when he said, you do not know what you ask. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink and be baptized with a baptism that I am baptized with? And then they said, we are able. They didn't really understand what Jesus was saying here, talking about this cup and this baptism. You know, what was Jesus talking about? Well, the cup that he would drink and the baptism that he would undergo would be his suffering and death on the cross. The suffering and death he would soon endure when he would die on the cross as a sacrifice for the sins of the world. Jesus used this language at other times in the Garden of Gethsemane. You may recall when he prayed to his Father in heaven, and his prayer request was, if there's any way, let this cup pass from me, the cup of the sufferings. He refers to it as drinking out of a cup. Back in Luke chapter 12, he referred to his death as a baptism that he had to undergo. And so here in response to the disciples, asking for this great position of prominence in his kingdom, he tells them they don't know what they're asking. They don't really know what they're talking about. And Jesus responds to them saying, are you able to drink the cup that I'm going to drink and undergo the baptism that I am going to undergo? Jesus is talking about his suffering and death. And what he is saying, crucially, is that for him, the necessary pathway to glory in the kingdom was the pathway of suffering and death. That was the road he was traveling. And he was asking them, can you travel that road with me? Are you prepared to follow me on the path of suffering and death on the way to the kingdom and glory? Now, Jesus went on to say in verse 39, after they said, we are able, he said, well, You will indeed drink the cup that I drink, and with the baptism I am baptized with, you will indeed be baptized. What was he referring to? Well, after Jesus went to the cross, and after the disciples deserted him, but then after they were witnesses of his resurrection and they received power, when the Holy Spirit came upon them on the day of Pentecost, they would go round preaching the gospel in the power of the Spirit. And James and John, along with all the other apostles, they would experience sufferings and ultimately martyrdom on their way to the kingdom and glory. That would be the path that they would follow. But at the time they were having this conversation, they didn't really grasp that. They didn't really understand that. They weren't thinking about suffering and death. They were thinking about honor and glory. That's what they were thinking about. And so while all this conversation was going on, verse 41 tells us that the other disciples heard it. The 10, they heard it. And what happened? Well, they began to be greatly displeased with James and John. Now, why were they displeased with James and John? Well, it wasn't because they thought James and John were wrong to ask for a position of prominence in the kingdom. They were greatly displeased because they wanted that position of prominence for themselves. And so we have this interesting dynamic. Jesus is having this conversation and the disciples are arguing amongst themselves, who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom? I want the position of prominence. No, I want the position of prominence. No, I want to be the greatest. No, 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 I'm going to be the greatest. You know, these kinds of things are not uncommon. And we see the disciples having this argument. And so what does Jesus do? Well, Jesus then takes the opportunity to drive home his point to the entire group of the 12. Verse 42, he says, he called them to himself and he said to them, you know that those who are considered rulers over the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. In other words, you know that the ungodly are only concerned with power and authority and exercising that power over others. Yet, verse 43, Jesus says, it shall not be so among you. But whoever desires to be great among you shall be your servant. And whoever of you desires to be first shall be the slave of all. And so Jesus uses this entire conversation as an opportunity to make what really was a revolutionary statement concerning greatness in his kingdom. He is saying to his disciples, if you want to be great in my kingdom, the pathway to glory is the pathway of suffering and death. If you want to be great in my kingdom, you must be a servant. You must be the slave of all. Now, what did he mean? Slave of all. Well, Jesus explains it in verse 45. Because he says, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. What does it mean to be the slave or the servant of all? Notice the two key words there in verse 45. Serve and give. Jesus came to serve and to give his life. His serving ultimately led to his dying. In other words, the true servant is one who gives his life in sacrificial service. And so, Jesus had told James and John that the way to glory was the way of suffering and death. He told the rest of his disciples altogether that to be great in the kingdom, you need to be the servant of all. And then in verse 45, he gives himself as the example. He gives his own life as the example of what it means to be the servant of all. And so when we really think about the reality of Jesus' words here, we realize that this is quite serious stuff. This is quite a high calling. This is true Christian discipleship. A little bit earlier in Mark chapter 8, verses 34 through 36, Mark tells us that when Jesus had called the people to himself with his disciples also, he said to them, "Whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul?" You see, Jesus was on the pathway to glory. And the call to discipleship is the call to follow him on that same path to glory. Now, oftentimes when we read this passage, and we read these words of Jesus to his disciples, we focus on what it means for us. We focus on the fact that Jesus says that we are to be the servants of all. And indeed, we need to focus on that. That is important. That is the lesson that Jesus is teaching his disciples. It is a lesson of sacrificial service, and that is important. But Jesus is not just saying to the disciples, "You need to follow my example." Notice in verse 45 again what he said. He said, "I came not to be served, but to serve." So before it's ever about our serving him, it's about his serving us. Now, this is the gospel. This is the gospel. And this is remarkable, so remarkable at times it can sound like it must be wrong. But Jesus in verse 45 is talking about how he serves us. How Jesus, the King of Glory, serves us. And how has Jesus served us? By giving his life a ransom for many. That word ransom, it speaks of the price paid to free a slave. The word for many speaks of in place of. Jesus gave his life as the price to be paid to free us from slavery to sin, to free us from the righteous penalty of sin, which is death and eternal judgment. Jesus came to serve us before we ever thought about serving him. Jesus loved us before we ever thought about loving him. And it was because of his great love for us that he came into this world and lived a life without sin, a perfect life, a life that we could not live on account of our sin. And he did that precisely so he could give his life for us, so that he could pay the penalty of death for us, pay the ransom price to redeem us from sin. And notice, Jesus gave his life, his one life, his perfect life, to ransom the lives of many. Jesus' sacrifice on the cross was sufficient to pay the penalty for the sins of the world because of who Jesus Christ was. Because he was God in human flesh. And you see, this is the gospel. This is why Jesus came. He came to give his life as a sacrifice for our sins. He came to serve us through giving his life. And we know that to be true because on the third day, Jesus Christ conquered sin and death when he rose from the dead. And so, as we bring it to a close, really, this morning, this is very much a call to discipleship. It is a call to wholehearted commitment to loving and serving Jesus. But if we are to truly serve the Lord, and if we are to truly serve others, we need to recognize that first and foremost, it's not about our serving of him, but it's about his serving us. And Christ has served us through his sacrificial death on the cross. And he's still serving us even now. When Jesus gave the Great Commission to his disciples, he said, you know, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all the things I have commanded you. And then what did he say? He said, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Jesus is with us. And he is with us all the time because his Spirit dwells within us. And he is serving us even now by giving us the power, the strength, the comfort, the ability that we need to serve him. Now you see why it's important to recognize his serving us before we think about our serving of him. Because unless we receive from him, we don't have the ability to give back. It's the same is true of our love. We are called to love God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. And we're called to love our neighbor as ourselves. We're even called to love our enemies. And how can we do that? We can do that because the love of God has been poured out in our heart by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. We love him because he first loved us. If we want to love others, we first need to become recipients of God's love. If we want to truly serve others, we first need to become recipients of our Lord's serving us. And he is with us always, empowering us and enabling us to serve him and to serve others. But there's a wonderful verse in Hebrews chapter 7 and verse 25, which tells us that Jesus Christ always lives to make intercession for us. Jesus is exalted at the right hand of the Father on high, even right now. And what's he doing? Well, one of the things he's doing is making intercession for us. He's serving. He is empowering. He is praying for us. And that is a remarkable thing. And knowing what Christ has done for us, he gave his life as a ransom for many. Knowing that Christ is with us always, his Spirit dwells within us to empower us and enable us to do all he's called us to do. Knowing that Christ is in heaven,
interceding for us before the Father. That we have an advocate with the Father in heaven, even Jesus Christ, the righteous. Knowing, receiving, embracing all of these things are what enable us then, with all humility, having become recipients of God's amazing grace, to give our lives in service to Him. That is what a true servant is. One who gives his life in service, first of God, and also of others. Remember what Jesus said in John chapter 15, verse 5. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. How often do we try to do things without Jesus? We need to recognize, receive, and give thanks for God's grace. You know, when Christ said that I came not to be served, but to serve and give his life a ransom for many, that's God's grace. It's what Christ has done for us. When Christ says, and lo, I will be with you always, even to the end of the age, that's God's grace. That's what Christ is doing in and through us. When we read that Christ ever lives to make intercession for us, and that he is able to save to the uttermost all who have come to him through faith, you see, that's God's grace that will sustain us all the way to eternal glory. We cannot live the Christian life apart from God's grace. By grace we have been saved. In grace we stand. It's God's grace that is sufficient for us. We stand. It's God's, and it's his grace which will appear to us one day when Jesus Christ returns to take us home to be with him. And this really is the message of the gospel. This is the purpose for which Jesus Christ came, to serve and to give his life so that we may be saved and to give us the power that we need to overcome sin and live a life that is pleasing to God. So let us commit ourselves afresh this morning to trusting in the Lord for all things, depending upon his grace in everything, to being recipients daily of what the Lord is giving to us so that we might receive that strength and in turn be able to serve God and serve others so that the Lord's church may be strengthened and built up so that the Lord's kingdom may be extended in this world and so that he may be glorified in and through each and every one of us. Father, we thank you for your word to us today, and we thank you for all that you have done for us in and through Jesus Christ. Father, help us by your grace, in response to the great love which you have demonstrated toward us, having received Christ's service of us, help us in the power that you supply to in turn commit our lives afresh to giving our lives in sacrificial service of you and of others. And may this be unto the praise and honor of your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let us all stand together. We'll sing a closing song.
Who breaks the power of sin? Shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us free.
Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. May God bless you all.